Good morning. It is really good to be with you all, and thank you, Reverend Blackman, for reading our scripture for us today. In Luke 14, we are told that Jesus went to the home of one who had power, who had status, who was a leader in the community, and he watched the people there and saw them pursuing power and status, notice, admiration of others. And then Jesus acted against their notions of what ought to be admired, what ought to give you status. He healed someone on the Sabbath. He asked the individuals there, what do you truly love? What does it mean to be genuinely good to people? He warns us against pursuing honor and status, calls us to care for the poor, the blind, the crippled, and the lame. What I'd like to do today is introduce you to someone I love dearly, a friend of mine, although I've never met her. She's someone who did not gain significant power or status, who was not in her own lifetime greatly admired. Honestly, her life was by most measures a failure. She began her life with the promise of greatness. She had a shot at power. She had a shot at real place in society, but her life ended with very little and with most of her major projects lying in ruins. I want to introduce you to her in part because all of you here have a shot at status. That you're here gives you different kinds of opportunities than the kinds of opportunities other people may have. I realize that some of you are here after a great deal of struggle and difficulty. For some of you, you might feel a little bit like an imposter, wondering if you're up to the challenge. Some of you might be thinking about what you could have done and where you could have gone. But regardless of how you got here and the particular set of challenges you may face, each of you have a shot at being admired in your communities, of having power, of having status, of having a place of honor at the table. I'm sorry to tell you, however, and I'm sure you already know this, your lives will not be easy. Nearly all of our lives include at least various points, some degree of suffering. Both minor suffering and significant suffering. There's good reason to expect that your lives are not going to be wholly peaceable or uneventful. They may not look a whole lot like your current plans for your life. It's quite possible that you may live a life that includes the seemingly promised power, status, notice, admiration, but you may not. I'd like to introduce you to my friend Edith, in part because your story may be like hers, in the sense of being quite different than what you intended your life to be. Part of what I admire about her is that although her life did not turn out as she hoped, although her projects failed consistently and terribly, although her life was marked by a series of disappointments, a kind of fragmentation, hers was nonetheless a good life. Even a triumphant life. Part of our vision of successful and failed lives can get tied up with our vision of power and status. Her life was, in terms of power, status, honor, it was a failure. And yet she failed in ways that I think can speak to us. I first met her about 20 years ago, over 20 years ago now. I got a phone call. I had been talking with a friend of mine over the summer about my thoughts for a dissertation, and he called to tell me he had my dissertation topic. He wanted me to write on Edith Stein. I had never heard of her, but his brief account of her philosophic journey matched my own intellectual path, and so I decided to begin research, see what I could find out. I started a reading group, reading her writings, which my now husband joined. And I started incorporating features of her thought into my grad school papers. Although much of my research focused on her philosophy, it's impossible to avoid being drawn into her life, and I'd like to share a bit of that life story. This is my first picture of Edith Stein. She was born in 1891 in eastern Germany. It's an area that's now part of Poland, but was part of Germany at the time. She was the youngest child of an assimilated Jewish family. She was precocious, she was lively, she was much loved. She was very successful in school, much like you all. And she was among the first women to enter the universities when they opened to women at the turn of the century. At that time, Edmund Husserl was the rising intellectual star, or one of the rising stars in Germany, and she read Husserl's breakthrough works. She decided to go study with him, went to the university where he taught. Eventually, she wrote a dissertation under him, published major books in his journal, and worked as his private assistant, editing some of his most significant writings. She was going places. She had a degree unheard of for women a few decades earlier. She was working on cutting-edge topics. She was shaping crucial debates. She was part of an intellectual revolution. She had the right connections. She had the right relationships. She had a shot. But then she didn't make it. She tried. In Germany, I don't know how familiar you are with the process of getting a job in universities at Germany, but you have to write a second dissertation in order to apply for a job. It's called a Habilitationsschrift. She wrote her second dissertation in order to apply. Husserl recommended her. He spoke warmly of her work, praised her very highly, but then he ended his recommendation letter with the phrase, quote, "Should the academic profession become open to women, I would recommend Dr. Stein immediately and most warmly." It did not become open to women. She didn't get the job. She's a bit of a personality, and so she wrote a letter of protest to the authorities in Berlin, and they did change the law, and they said that you could not use sexism as a basis for discrimination in university hiring. It didn't help her, but she did get the law changed. This failing to get a job was not, however, the only thing going wrong in her life. It's not crystal clear exactly who she was interested in romantically, but we can guess about a few of the people she liked. If I'm right in my guesses, one of the men she liked married her sister. Another, her best friend, with whom she shared so much intellectually, informed her. After she took the initiative and hinted that she'd like something more, he informed her that he had a fiancé back in Poland. There may have been a third romantic interest, but he got caught up in a scandal and had an illegitimate child, which ended her interest in him. Her hopes for romance failed, and she never got married. Edith did, though, find Jesus. There are lots of events that I think contributed to her conversion. Certainly, she had a number of close Lutheran friends, one of whom lost her husband during World War I and was a real model of faith and hope in that time. She loved the hymns of Martin Luther. She was deeply moved by many of those songs. She worked through Ignatius of Loyola's spiritual exercises, and Edmund Husserl himself was a Christian, and there were a number of Christians in her intellectual circles that I think were surely role models. But it was the reading of the life of Teresa of Avila that was the key event for her conversion. She stayed up all night reading the autobiography and committed her life to Christ and entered the Catholic Church on January 1st, 1922. Edith had Jesus, and she also had the whole worldwide community of Christians, both living and dead. But she didn't have a job. So she took up a much less impressive job teaching at a girls' high school. About 5 or 6 years into her high school teaching, the opportunity to make good on her education, her connections, and her formation arrived again. She was invited by one of the leading theologians to participate in a major translation project and to become a speaker addressing issues of feminism, education, and vocation. It was for her a chance to use her degree and her training. And so she agreed to do both. Stein traveled throughout Europe giving lectures. She gave a whole series of radio addresses, and she began translating the works of both Thomas Aquinas and John Henry Newman into German. It looked like she might again get the scholarly credit necessary to be hired by a university. So she again wrote a second dissertation, she again applied for jobs, and she again failed to get them. She did get a different job, however, at a teacher's training institute in Münster. It was not a university job, but it did give her some greater opportunity, and she was soon invited by the authorities in Berlin to participate in a nationwide educational reform program. She was very happy to do so. Reworking education was a passion for her. This was the period in Germany between the two world wars, the late 1920s and early 1930s. The country was restless. It was struggling under the terms of the Versailles Treaty that ended World War I. Jews were being scapegoated, and the National Socialist Party was starting to have greater influence. So Stein took to her platform as a teacher, a public speaker, an educational leader, to argue publicly against National Socialism. She joined and spoke on behalf of a group called the White Rose Society, which was dedicated to challenging the National Socialist. She deepened her own sense of her Jewish heritage, and in the 1930s, out of Münster came a series of pamphlets. We don't know exactly who wrote the pamphlets, but they came out of the Catholic diocese in Münster, and they sure look like they have the mark of Stein's hand on some of the arguments. She actively challenged and rebutted various claims of the National Socialist. And then in early 1933, just a few months after Hitler came to power, Stein wrote a letter to Pope Pius XI, laying out what she expected to happen as the Nazis gained power. She asked the Pope to write an encyclical then, in 33, condemning racism and anti-Semitism. She made clear that the Church needed to act early before things got significantly worse, before the National Socialist began more deeply to compromise the churches. And she began writing her own autobiography, giving a portrait of life in a Jewish family, trying to humanize the Jews for the German people, showing a fuller, more adequate picture of the people being increasingly condemned. As you know, Stein and the others protesting did not make much of a dent. The Nazis came to power, the Pope did not publish an encyclical, and Stein lost her newly acquired job because of her Jewish background. Just 2.5 months after Hitler came to power, she lost yet another job. In 1933, she stood at this crossroad. Stein could see that there was now little hope for a teaching career or having any kind of public platform. Hope for power or status, or even making use of her education, experience, and degrees, was seemingly lost. So Edith followed the steps of Teresa of Avila, becoming like her mentor, a Carmelite nun. Each of the Catholic orders has a special calling or distinction. The Carmelites are dedicated to prayer. The Carmelite order is one of the most cloistered orders in the Catholic Church, and their deep commitment is to a life of radical prayer for others. At this time in history, this is no longer true, but at this time in history, Carmelite nuns would not leave the convent. They would only meet with others in a room where the nun would be on one side of a door and then would speak to her visitors through a little grate. The nuns would do various household tasks. They'd clean, garden, cook, but they would spend most of their hours dedicated to prayer, both private prayer and communal prayer. Stein entered the Carmelites knowing that she would be giving up a normal life with friends and family. She did not go to her mother's funeral. She did not visit her friends or family except via letters or their visits to the convent. She even gave up her name. She became Sister Benedicta a Cruce, Sister Benedicta of the Cross. A couple of years into her time in the convent, a surprising request was made of Stein. This is, as far as I know, the first time this ever happened in the history of the Carmelites. But for the first time, the superiors came to her and asked her if she would resume her scholarly writing. She still needed to keep the schedule of prayer, but she was freed from cooking, gardening, and sewing, and she dedicated those hours to renewing her scholarship and finishing off some books she had not completed. There in the convent in Cologne, she finished her great magnum opus, Finite and Eternal Being, an attempt to ascend to the meaning of being. This is probably one of my favorite books in the whole world. It is a grand bringing together of contemporary German phenomenology, Thomistic metaphysics, Carmelite spirituality, and extensive discussions of quantum physics, various interpretations of matter, debates regarding the soul, and reflections on the Trinity. It is an ambitious book. It touches on crucial questions in philosophy and presents an account of how we might bring together ancient and medieval insights with contemporary scientific and philosophic concerns. Stein would spend months waiting to receive a book she requested on atomic physics. She studied text on evolutionary theory. She worked with Latin, Greek, and French text. And finally, she found a publisher. The process of editing this mammoth book was long, but she got through the page proofs, and the publisher, Borgmeier, created the metal plates that were necessary at the time to print the book. And then the laws against publications by Jews came out, and the publishing house would not print it. In 1938, the violence against Jews started in earnest. We have Kristallnacht, the Night of Broken Glass, in November of that year. Stein was slipped by her sisters, her religious sisters, out of Germany in the dead of the night, New Year's Eve, 1938. She had what remained of her unpublished scholarly work in the trunk of the car, hidden under a series of packages as she was slipped over into the Netherlands. She joined a convent in the Netherlands. But by 1940, the Nazis took over the Netherlands as well. This is the last photo we have of her from 1941. It is a photo required by the Nazi authorities for registration of Jews. On August 2nd, 1942, the Nazis knocked on the convent door, and Stein was handed over. A number of years ago, I was at a conference. I hadn't really thought about this, but a nun there pointed out to me that surely the religious sisters in the convent knew why the authorities were knocking on the door. When they asked for Edith Stein, surely the sisters knew why they wanted her and what was going to happen, or at least they must have guessed what was likely to happen. But they handed her over. She was put on a train to Auschwitz and was gassed within 2 days of arriving. At the end of her life, she had given up or lost all but the most limited contact with many people in her family. Her relationships with her friends occurred primarily through letters. She failed to get jobs for which she was more than qualified. She failed in her major publishing projects, failed to be heard within her society or even her church. In the end, she was even in some respects abandoned by the religious sisters with whom she lived. The convent where she lived in the Netherlands and where she had hid most of her scholarly life work suffered in the bombings. The religious sisters there fled, and her unpublished writings were left to the elements, disorganized and abandoned amid the rubble of war. Her life was, by the criteria of status, power, admiration, and place, a complete failure. She had opportunities. She had education. She had connections. She had promise. But none of it came to anything like what it should have, what one would have expected it to come to. And Stein had to have died, thinking that much of the energy she had put out, much of the work that she had done, had little effect. Part of what I love about Edith Stein, however, is not simply the rather tragic and painful story, but also that a second thread runs through her whole life as well, a drumbeat that appears to intensify over time and with each failure. When Stein did not get the teaching post because she was a woman, she begins teaching girls, dedicating her time to women's education. After growing up in a fairly assimilated Jewish family and downplaying her background during the first part of her life, she begins to celebrate it in the second. As anti-Semitism was on the rise in Germany, Stein spoke of her own Jewish heritage. As hatred against Jews increased, she begins noticing the patterns, researching, seeking to understand deeply what is going on, and launching a fight against it. As she loses her post and her public voice, as she's silenced by her society, she dedicates herself to a life of radical prayer for others, talking continually to God. When her most significant and grand work cannot be published, she begins writing for her Carmelite sisters. She starts to write little pieces for the convent in honor of various holidays, little plays, small poems. She even begins translating the text of the great Spanish mystic, John of the Cross, not for publication, but so that her fellow nuns in the convent could become familiar with this thought. When she's sent on the train to die, she spends her limited time before her own death caring for the children on the train with her and in the various wayside camps, comforting the families and providing hope for others as they too face their death. Her life was a failure. If success is measured in terms of societal influence, status, or power. But if we measure success instead in terms of the formation of a soul, of an increasing joy and delight in caring for others, then her life was certainly not a failure. She came to the point where she could happily throw a banquet inviting the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, those who could never return anything to her. There's nothing wrong with status. We shouldn't shun power. Admiration from others is not an evil, but none of them make a life. We ought not to pursue power or status or admiration for its own sake. They are not worth having for their own sake. Because of our commitment to what is true, what is good, what is holy, and what is beautiful, we can and should use power, status, a place in society to defend the poor, to speak for the oppressed, to heal the lame. But power, status, place, admiration are always secondary, and they're never actually ours. They are gifts that you may be offered for a time, or you may not be. But true success and failure in life is not measured by these gifts, but by one's dedication to what truly makes a life worthwhile. And by that measure, Stein's life strikes me as not only a good one, but a triumphant one. After Stein's death, Hermann von Breda, who's the founder of the Husserl Archives in Leuven, and his assistant, Lucy Gelber, went to the convent in the Netherlands where Stein last lived. They sifted through the rubble. They got help from the townspeople. They collected all the pieces and half pieces of paper still left from Stein's writings. Lucy Gelber then dedicated her life to reconstructing Stein's text. She lovingly and painstakingly pieced together Stein's autobiography. She gathered the spiritual writings written for the nuns. She did the colossal work of putting in order Stein's great philosophical opus. She found letters and papers written to or given to friends, and slowly Lucy Gelber and others have recreated Stein's scholarly life work. Stein's Polish love interest, the man who was engaged to someone else, went on to become the teacher of Carol Wojtyła, who became Pope John Paul II. John Paul II read Stein's writings. He incorporated many of her thoughts into his own writing and his talks. And in 1998, John Paul II declared Edith Stein a saint. She's now known as Saint Edith Stein, or Saint Teresa Benedicta a Cruce. John Paul recommended her writings in his pastoral letter on faith and reason, pointing to her as a person modeling how to integrate faith and learning, and she was named one of the three co-patronesses of Europe. Her writings have, at this point, been translated into many, many languages, and the translation projects are ongoing. Just 5 years ago, the German critical edition of her works, now numbering 27 volumes, was finally finished. There's an international group of scholars working on her philosophy. There are thousands of articles and books about her thought, as well as several movies and an opera. Power, status, admiration have come to her, but not in the way that she sought, nor in any way that she could experience while on earth. While here, she passionately and deeply pursued that for which and those for whom power, influence, status, and fame ought to serve. At the end of our reading from Luke, Jesus said to his host, "When you give a luncheon or dinner, do not invite your friends, your brothers or sisters, your relatives, or your rich neighbors. If you do, they may invite you back, and so you will be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed. Although they cannot repay you, you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous." Amen.